Hi, in this video, we are going to see a simple introduction of autoencoders. Basically, autoencoders is a neural network that learns to copy its input to output. If you see X is the input and X bar is the output. Now, this may look like an identity function, but the uniqueness of autoencoder is the output X bar is constrained compared to the X. Now I will talk about it as I go into the detail. Let's first understand an autoencoder architecture to understand what the output of autoencoder will be. Now an autoencoder can be divided into two parts. One is the encoder over here and second is the decoder. Now the encoder is mapping from input space X into a lower dimension latent space. And this Z is the lower dimension space, and it's also called the bottleneck layer. So basically you have an input, you have a bottleneck layer over here. And this is a lower dimension space. Now at this stage, it is nothing but lower dimension representation of the data, and it's completely in an unsupervised manner. So autoencoders are unsupervised learning technique. You don't need a labeled data. Now, what it does over here is nothing but a dimensionality reduction as to what a simple PCA does. But the potential benefit of autoencoder here is how they treat non-linearity in the data. So basically, it allows model to learn very powerful generalization compared to your PCA. And it can reconstruct back the output with significantly lower loss of information than PCA in a nonlinear space. So that's the advantage of autoencoder over PCA. Your PCA is completely on a linear data set, and here it's going to be on a nonlinear data space. Right. Now that's about encoder. So encoder takes an input X and convert into a lower dimension space. And this space can be directly used for your dimensionality reduction, and you can directly feed it into your model. And if you want to reconstruct the space, that's where the decoder comes into play. So the decoder is nothing but it takes the data from the lower dimension latent space into a reconstruction space where the dimensionality of the output X bar is equal to the output X. So now if you see X bar is equal to X, but if you think like a compression, right? So what it do is if you take an image, you compress an image and you uncompress it, you typically have lossless compression, right? You get the image as it is. But in case of an autoencoder, it is basically a lossy compression. So it compresses and uncompresses, and when it uncompresses it, it tries to be close to the input, but not exactly close. That's the difference between like a typical lossy algorithm and a lossless algorithm, right? So basically your autoencoder can also be used in image compression techniques and everything, but you will have a lossless compression over, so a lossy compression over there. In this case, the difference between the output representation and the input representation is called the reconstruction error. Basically, the error between your input vector and output vector, that's called the reconstruction error. One potential use case of autoencoder is anomaly detection. While there are plenty of use cases of autoencoder, the predominant use case that we can think of is anomaly detection. And the reconstruction error that we are talking about between the output to the input is what we use to detect whether an input is an anomaly or not. I'm going to more focus on anomaly detection here on. So think about cases where your IoT sensors or machines or even your sensors in your CPU and memory devices. Typically, there is one in a million possibility, lot of cases in this machinery and IoT sensor to fail. And you will not have a lot of negative instances. Your data is completely imbalanced, but you will have a lot of positive instances. And it's very difficult to basically train a model with such high imbalance. And that's where like autoencoders are pretty much superior modeling technique in these cases, where you have very low 0.001% of error samples. While it can be used with more like higher negative samples as well, that's also quite possible, where you don't have a lot of labels in that case. So sometimes it's very difficult labeling or very expensive labeling the data, but you know your normal behavior. So basically what you can do is you can train your model with the normal data, and then when you are doing an inference or evaluation, you can see how the data performs against the abnormal data. So I'm going to explain that in detail. So what you do is you pass your autoencoder with the majority classes, all the normal data in this case. You will train your model only with the normal data. or the majority classes. The training objective for the autoencoder in this case is to minimize the reconstruction error. We said reconstruction error is the error between the output and input, and the training objective of this autoencoder here is to minimize the reconstruction error over here. Now, as the training progresses, the model weights are updated over here, the encoder and decoder. The encoder is nothing but a downsampler and decoder is nothing but an upsampler. I'm going to show some of the architecture examples. And this encoder and decoder, the encoder and decoder can be your typical feed-forward neural network. It can be a convolution neural network or it can be an LSTM neural network. Right. So as the training progresses, the model weights are updated to minimize the difference between the encoder input and the encoder output. Now, what this autoencoder does, it learns a reconstruction function that works well with normal data. Right. Basically, you get a low reconstruction error and works poorly with an abnormal data. That is going to be your minority classes where the reconstruction error is pretty high. And we can use this reconstruction error for anomaly detection. So this is an example of an output from a trained model. And if you see, the model was trained using the normal data. And you can see the blue line is the actual data, whereas the red line is the output of the model. That is a reconstructed output. And you can see basically the model performs well on a normal data. And the reconstruction error is the difference between the blue line and red line. This is the reconstruction error. Now, what you do over here, when you pass an abnormal data, the model has not seen the abnormal data, right? If you see over here, it is not fitting correctly. The reconstruction error is pretty high. There's a sudden peak, there are lows and sudden high peaks and everything, right? So the model will not fit perfectly, and there'll be a high reconstruction error. And this reconstruction error is what you are going to set a threshold and then identify whether it's a normal data or anomaly data. So if you see this slide here, the distribution of your errors for normal sample is very small. The blue one is the normal sample. The distribution of this mean squared error is very small, whereas for your abnormal data is higher than the normal data. So when you're training an autoencoder, right, it's going to separate out your normal and abnormal classes. Basically, you can have slightly little labeled data so that you can evaluate your model. Right, but you can also use in the training validation, you can both use your trained data and your abnormal data and then see how the model performs. Now, this is how it looks like. Right now, what you do is you take the mean of your in this case, the mean of your normal data and put one or two standard deviation or even three standard deviation, depending on your business use case as a threshold. And when you feed in new data in real time, if the incoming data is above the threshold, then it's an anomaly. If it is less than the threshold, then it's a normal data. So that's how basically you train a neural network model to train an autoencoder model for anomaly detection. Now, as I said, your anomaly detection can be a feed-forward neural network. If you see your input data with 140 variables, right? And you have and downsampling, you have a 7-unit or feed-forward neural network, then you have a 3-unit, and then you have a 2-unit bottleneck layer, which can be your basically dimensionality reduction layer as well. And then what you do is, again, you have upsampling of the same size. So basically, you have 3 units, 7 units, and the output layer, which is similar to the input layer. And as I said, it's a lossy compression kind of, if you can correlate, it's kind of a lossy compression. So you'll have a reconstruction error that is between the output and input. Or it can be a convolution neural network where you take an image and then you reconstruct an image. The image will not be perfect. There are some cases where you can denoise an image. Basically, if you have a noisy image, you have denoising autoencoders which can denoise an image. And then you have an LSTM. And typically, it's used for time series models where you want the sequencing is important. You can use an LSTM model where you can feed a time series data set, and then you can basically find anomalies in time series, right? So these are some of the use cases. You can use it for dimensionality reduction, you can use it for anomaly detection, you can use it for either cases, like with IoT sensors or not, or even for normal fraud detection algorithms in banking. These have been proven successful over there. And then you can use it images, you can use for compression of images or denoising images. You can use for image processing. There are a lot of application of autoencoder. What I'm going to do in my next set of videos, I'm going to talk about how you can use autoencoders, how you can develop an autoencoder with some regular data set and time series data set. Thank you very much.